Amen.
If you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to the book of Psalms, the 126th Psalm. Psalms 126, we'll be reading this morning. Psalms 126, in the very first verse. The Bible says, "When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord had done great things for them. The Lord had done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Then they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him." Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your blessings and your watch care. We thank you for your goodness that's just provided your word this morning. We praise you for that, Lord. To have the entirety of your goodness before us in your word is more than we could understand. Lord, we praise you for all that you do for us. Lord, we pray this morning that it might seem well with you to meet with us, Lord, that you'd stir us up to your service. God, help us as a people together that we'd be found faithful in you. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now here we find a psalm that is not really given, that we do not know the author. We do not know who penned these words. But we do know that they came from the mouth of God. Now, to get the beauty of this psalm, you have to understand that they were in Babylonian captivity when this happened. Now, whether you want to admit it or not, or whether you're saved or you're lost, you are in captivity because we're not home with the Lord yet. Right. We're in a captivity presently here in this place. Because we don't enjoy the full presence of God. Now, one day, I believe we will. I know we will when we reach glory. But right now, we're hampered and hindered by this flesh. And so, he begins, "When the Lord turned again to the captivity, the imprisoned, the jailed of Zion." In other words, he didn't, you know what? What their fleshly desire is or was just to be released and sent back home. But the truth is, that wasn't the will of God, at least not yet. He would accomplish it later. So, you know, what I have found from the flesh is this: we want the easy way out. The path of least resistance, and we kind of like when we say frog, we like people to jump. You know what? It don't always work that way. And here we find that the psalmist began that you can have happiness in your captivity. You can have happiness in the place that he puts you. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. In other words, they thought they were dreaming. God is showing back up. He's meeting with us again. He's present among us. It's like we're dreaming. And you know what? We don't hold that precious enough. When God shows up, you know, it ought to be like a dream. Like, we can't believe this is happening. God has looked on us enough that he would meet with us. That's like a dream. You know, many people don't ever experience that. Live the entirety of their life. And so they weren't worried about captivity, but they were thrilled that God saw fit to meet with them. Notice verse 2. "Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing." Now, again, you want to do things the right way when it comes to the Lord. Always remember that. So what they found out first is God was meeting with them, even in their captivity. God was meeting with them, and then they sang. Then they give great. Have you ever heard somebody that sang just because they like to hear themselves sing? I have. I mean, I'm being serious. You know what? God ain't within 1,000 miles of that. You say, "Well, you're judging." No, most certainly I'm not. Because, see, when God motivates you to sing, there's a difference. There's a huge difference. And so, because God was meeting with them, and He had met with them, the singing was the result, not the cause. And we live in a day and age today where they think if they can sing and hoop and holler enough, God will come down and meet with them. No, it's always been the opposite way. God meets with you, and worship is the result. You can't worship something that's not meeting with you. If you have a lot of certain groups, they can, people who scream and holler and flop and carry on, you know who they remind me of is the Baptist. Because you remember when Elijah came up against 400 prophets and how they screamed and hollered and cut themselves, and God never did show up. You know what? In one sense, they had the cart before the horse. When God shows up, then start worshiping, and not the other way around. Because it just doesn't work that way. And so we see that as Israel's in this place, God meets with them. They begin to worship, even though they're in the captivity, they begin to worship the Lord. It says, "Our tongue with singing, then said they among the heathen." Now notice this. "Then said they among the heathen, the Lord have done great things for them." Now who were the heathen in that day? Well, it was the Babylonians, the one that they were in captivity to. It said, they began to say, "Listen, the Lord's done great things for them. Look at those people. We've got them locked up. They're our slaves, and they appear to be happy. God's done great things for them." You know what? We ought to be the most happy people on the face of this earth this morning. Listen, saved, on our way to glory, near unto Christ. That ought to be God's seed. You know what? We're in captivity right now. But we ought to be the most happy people there was. One day we'll be delivered. You know, that's Paul knew what he was talking about. He said, "Oh, who will deliver me from the body of this death?" One day we will be set free. But until we're set free, we ought to be the happiest people around. You remember Eeyore, little donkey character on Winnie the Pooh? That little cloud of gloom and doom always following him right behind him. That's how most Baptists are. It ought not to be so. Listen, we're the Lord's people. We're the people of the church age. We belong to Him, and we ought to lift Him up and give Him praise. And not get this, "Oh man, everything's so bad. What are we going to do? Boo hoo. What are we going to do next? Boo hoo again." No, we are the people of God, and they impressed those that were around them because they're in the captivity were still giving God great praise. Verse 3, "The Lord had done great things for us, wherefore," or "whereof, we are glad." The Lord had done great things for us. And you know what? He's done a great and wonderful thing for me. He saved my never dying soul and placed me in His presence. You know what? If that's all that He'd ever done for me, I owe Him praise for the rest of my days here on earth. You know what? But He did so much more for me than that. You know what? I have a decently healthy body. You say, "Well, that's debatable." And no, you know what? I got up this morning, and I got my Bible out, and I read it, and then I went and gave myself a shower, and then I fed myself, and then I drove myself to church and had enough sense to open the door. Man, that's a great thing, isn't it? When you can't even crawl out of the bed on your own, then that becomes a great and wondrous and marvelous thing. God's been good to me. He has been so good to me. There shouldn't be no Molly Grubbs, no, it's me. Listen, and He's been good to you. You know what? Even if you're lost, the very breath that you just inhaled, God give it to you because His goodness and His mercy and His grace. God's been good. He's been exceedingly well above anything that we should hope or ask. That is the God of the Bible. So, the people around them didn't quite get it. And if you love the Lord this morning, and you have a sincere mind to serve the Lord, you know what? People are not going to get it. Like, man, he's crazy. What's he got to rejoice over? They don't even have this, and they don't even have that. Put it all aside. God's done great things. He's done great things for us, and we ought to be able to give Him praise and glory for it. Verse 4. "Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. Now, verse 4 of this praise is the only thing you get a tiny request of. And we've been talking some about prayer lately and the model prayer that the Lord Jesus gave. We've talked about there's only 7 words in that whole prayer that address requests. Here we find a little thing he says, turn again. And they compare it to the rivers of the south. The rivers of the south come down and then they turn back up. That was one little indication. Well, maybe they wanted to go back to Jerusalem. Maybe they wanted to go home. But you know what? They didn't dwell on it. Please do this. Please do that. And I need this. And I need that. No. Just a very brief say no. It'd be good to be in the homeland again. But I'm satisfied right here.
Yeah.
You know what? We as a people need to learn to be satisfied. Just glorify God wherever we're at. Give Him praise and glory and give Him honor. And don't stress about it. Don't be upset about it. Just give Him the praise for who He is. Verse 5. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. Now, a lot of people think there's a disconnect there, but there's not. Because see, while they were waiting on the Lord to come back, to show up again, they were sowing. And you know what they was crying about? They weren't crying about the captivity. They was crying because the Lord wasn't there. That's what they was crying about. And you know what never ceases to amaze me? Is we don't cry over that. We can go, come down to the church, know full well that the Lord hadn't met with us, and go out that door and simply blame it on the sovereignty of God. Listen, when God don't meet with us, there's a reason He doesn't meet with us. There is a purpose. Because you know what? He enjoys fellowship with His people. But none members of the Godhead is ever going to put their approval on sin. And the Holy Ghost is not going to show up when just abject sin in our life. You know why He's not going to? It's not of His own character. He's holy, He's righteous, He's good, He's glorious. And saying, you know what, your sin is okay. You're so important to me, I'm going to compromise myself and come into a place of sin. He will never, ever, ever do that. And so we see then the reaping had already come. They were in the harvest period. They were enjoying again the presence of the Almighty God of heaven. And I want you to see that they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. What were they reaping? They were reaping the presence of Almighty God. They were reaping and enjoying the great fellowship. Listen, you know what? This is a good missionary text, but listen, it ain't about going out there and bringing in the sheaves, as we'll see in verse 6 is sometimes. You know what the sheaves are? It's not necessarily people. You know what? If you come in here this morning rejoicing, you have a sheaf. You know what? I found this. Most sheaves are actually empty. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faith, mercy. Against such there's no law. You know what that is? That's a sheaf. And it ought to be full. It'll be so full that you can't hardly bring the string around it. But most of us don't even have that. Most of us don't even have that present in the barn, so to speak. And so when he begins to tell them this, he says, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. They were reaping by the presence of God. They were giving the laughter and the singing because of the presence of God. They had prepared for it, they had desired it, and God had shown up. That's how it ought to always be. Verse 6, he that goeth forth and weeping, he that goeth forth and weepeth. Now, how many people want to see some folks saved? Yeah. Got a lot of people on my heart this morning. Well, what I need to do is go forth weeping. You know what? I enjoy street preaching. I enjoy knocking on a few doors. But if I don't prepare myself
and go forth and weep here. I might as well stay at the house. Did you go forth weeping for this service this morning? Do you really want to see folks saved, or is it just another typical day? Those that go forth in weeping. So what I have come as a missionary thought is this: if I don't, I shouldn't want to expect God to do anything, right? He's not going to violate His character, is He? Is He? Certainly not. He's too righteous and holy and honest for that. So the very first thing we as missionary people ought to do is to go forth in weeping. Now, I do want you to see that the go forth comes first. You know what? You're not going to get anything done for the cause of Christ sitting down and doing nothing. You've got to go. And here comes all the excuses. I'm old. I'm young. I'm middle-aged. I have 4 kids. I have 2 kids. I have 1 kid. You know what? Put it all aside and go. That's all you can do. I don't care how many jobs you have, and I don't care. You know what? Go. 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 That's the only thing that you have to do. You know, isn't it an amazing thing that He said the very same thing to the church? The very first word of the Great Commission, go. Now, when you do go, we see that we're going to have to go forth in weeping. Yeah. You know what? It's hard to leave family behind, isn't it? Leave them and don't know if you ever see them again or not. Go forth in weeping. You know what? I say goodbye to Brother Downs a lot of times down at Nashville International. Good thing is we can call or we can email one another. Could you imagine 200 years ago when you sent them forth, you knew pretty much then you'd never see them again? That caused some weeping, wouldn't it? You know what we need when we go out here street preaching and door knocking? We need a real burden.
Yeah.
We need a real burden. And we need to be burdened for our children. We don't have 4, 5, 6 children, if you want to look at it. Who will be saved? It ought to break my heart every day. You know, it really should. Go forth and weep. You said, well, Anna made a profession. Well, I'm afraid that's about all Anna has. You say, oh, you're judging. Well, I don't see any sweet fruits of the Spirit. No, I'm just being honest, right? Why sugarcoat it? So you know what? I need to be praying. I need to be weeping over lost people, my kids, my grandchildren. You say, oh, your little grandchildren. Yes, my little grandchildren are little bitty fellas. And you know what? But the Bible says they came forth from the womb in a sinful condition. And I ought to be praying for them every day. And praying so I can weep about it. Now you say, well, I can't do that. Well, you think about an everlasting fires of hell, and it ought to make you weep. Someone that you love very dearly more than your own life being cast alive into the lake of fire. If that don't make you weep, I don't know what will. You know what? If that don't make you weep, I'd make my calling and election sure. You know what? When that's done, it's done.
Right. Yeah.
No recovery.
Amen.
You know, it's a shame and a disgrace. Blasphemous to doctrine praying someone out of hell, out of purgatory. The great whore came up with that. But you know what? As foul and vile as that is, in one sense, at least they're troubled about people being there. Well, you know, they're in hell now, and nothing more we can do about it. Well, I know what you're saying. We can't bring them back out. But do we spend sleepless nights in prayer before they arrive there? And you know what? And I know what you're all thinking. All on your back. Well, God's sovereignty. And you know what? We don't know who the elect are. And I'm going to deal with people I love like they are the elected of the elect. And I'm going to pray for them and seek God's face about them and preach the gospel to them until I have nothing left.
Yeah.
That's what a missionary does. That's what a missionary does. And so we see that as the psalmist is writing, that he says, he, the missionary, the lady, the individual, the church member, he that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed. This is the precious seed right here. Listen, if you don't think this book's under attack, you better wake up and smell the coffee. It's mine. You know what? Mary wasn't a young woman. She was a virgin. Means she'd never been with a man. Not Joseph or anybody else. There's a difference. Hey, listen, I know a lot of young women that ain't virgins, don't you? You say, oh, it's just a little bit of a change. Well, it's enough of a change to deny the deity of God, isn't it? It's enough change to deny the deity of Christ. That's enough to worry me, isn't it you? We need to be very cautious about adding our filthy, stinking works to redemption, because there's no place for it. Bearing precious seed, be sure you have the truth. Be sure you know what the truth is. You know what? A precious seed is not baptism. Don't shoot me yet. But whatever you say, that is not a precious seed. What the precious seed is the gospel. The fact that the Lord Jesus Christ embodied himself as a man and came and lived a sinless life. And willingly poured out his life's blood for you and I. That's the precious seed. The very fact to know that we can't come to him, but blessed be God, he can come to us. That's very, very precious seed. We need to bury it. And you know, today, you know, it's almost to the point we don't even know what the precious seed is. But the precious seed is the unadulterated Word of God. Everything that it says, we need to take it out. Bearing precious seeds shall doubtless, now if you underline your Bible, you get that, shall doubtless, there's no doubt, it's an assurity, doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves, his harvest, the pieces that he's garnered, bringing his sheaves with him, shall come again rejoicing. You know what? I don't know what kind of sheaves I'm going to have. I don't know what kind of sheaves you have. But I know that one day when I stand in glory, when I get home, I'll come rejoicing. I'll come giving great God. You know what? And you know what? I've messed up a lot. And you know, sometimes I get a little wary of myself. My first pastor wasn't the best. I was a big mouth, a 20-year-old boy. But you know what? I about got to the point that I don't knock myself down too much about it. Because if I said one word of truth there, I'll come back with joy. And that's how we ought to be. Don't beat yourself up over things that's said and done. You know, that's the devil's greatest trick bag. You know what? It don't matter what happened 40 years ago now, does it? You going to change the results? No. But if you said something offensive about, the best thing you can do is say, I'm sorry, and move on. Because you ain't going to change it. And dwell and roll around. You know what? If you're going to roll around in mud, you're going to come out dirty. That's all I'm going to tell you. Don't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. And if you stay in that mess and all you ever do is worry about what happened 10 years ago, listen, that's about all you ever did. And so we see then that we, as the Lord's people, need to be doing it right. We need to be bearing precious seed, and we need to be bearing precious seed in the right way. Now look with me in the book of Daniel. Daniel gives us a wonderful example of this. Daniel chapter number 6, very familiar verses of Scripture. Daniel 6 in verse 10. Daniel 6 in verse 10. Now what had happened is nobody could pray to anybody but, or let me say this, nobody could bow to anybody but the Babylonian leader. In other words, this was illegal. I say the mighty God of all heaven in Babylon done broke the law. And Daniel's accusers knew that about him. You know what? Daniel was a prayerful man, and they knew it. Now, don't expect people to do jumping jacks if you're a prayerful man, because they're not going to. In fact, if they possibly can, they use it against you. They'll use it against you just like they did for Daniel. And we find that Daniel is a faithful man. He's a praying man. Verse 10, the Bible says, "Now when Daniel knew the writing was signed," meaning that it was now illegal to pray, "he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chambers toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime." Now, I just want to interject something here for your help this week. It wasn't nothing new to Daniel. That was his life. That was his daily life. As he did, in other words, just because it became illegal to pray, he didn't get out there and start praying so everybody could see him. It was his habits. It was his natural course of life, what he did every day. He didn't change anything. They just knew that he would pray, and he kept on praying. So, don't try to impress people. Just keep doing what you're doing. Just continue to pray. And Daniel was a man that, he was hated in his day. No one liked him because of what he stood for. Now notice what it says in verse 7. excuse me. Verse 11. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. "Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save of thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions?" And the king answered, says, "This thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which altereth not." Now, I want you to see they had made that law against praying and bowing. Drop down to verse 16 with me. "Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee." Now I want you to notice a couple of things. First of all, that the circumstance did not change. See, what we want is the easy way out. You know what we as good Baptists would have been praying for? "Oh, get me out of the lion's den. Change the king's mind. Work on these people that hate me and change their attitude toward me." No. You know what? His prayer did not change. A lot of people say, I wonder what Daniel did that night. Everybody said, "Well, he's probably praying." But you know what? I don't know what Daniel did that night. And more than that, you don't know either. All I know is he went in alive and came out alive. That's all I need to know. And I know he was not a compromiser. Now, let me say this one more thing and we'll move on. Don't you wait for the lion's den to start praying. Because if you wait till the problem gets severe, your prayer life ain't going to mean a whole lot. You make some preparatory prayer and you be ready when the lion den comes, because it's on its way. It's near even unto you, and you'll get thrown off in there if you live long enough. Matthew chapter 14. Matthew 14. I'm going to begin reading verse 23. Matthew 14. And verse 23, the Bible says, "And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into the mountain apart to pray. And when evening was come, He was there alone. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things about prayer. If you know your Bible, you know what had happened, that he had prayed and the Lord had blessed the loaves and fishes, and he had fed 5,000 men besides the women and the children that were present there with him. From just from 5 loaves and 2 fishes, he had fed the whole multitude. He'd taken up the 12 baskets for the 12 apostles. You know what? God has provision for you. You ever think, it doesn't say how much the rest of them got. You know, I think it's full. But you know what? I think a basket portion is a lot more. He is going to meet our needs. He is going to provide the things that we stand in need of. We're not going to go hungry. We're not going to be in a situation like that. But I want you to see that after he sent them all away, and you know the story, he says, go take the ship and meet me on the other side. Now, they had a mixed level of faith, because he says, I'll be over there. I'm going to dismiss the crowd, and I'll meet you on the other side. Now, they did have a little bit of confidence in Christ, because they never said how you're going to get there. We're leaving in the last ship. How you going to make it before we get there? They didn't do that, so they got in. The Bible says he went up on the mountain part to pray. Now, listen, he didn't pray up a storm. Because you know why? Our Lord Jesus don't have to pray up a storm. It's there when he says so. And just as easy, he can say, peace be still. So he didn't need a prayer to do that. He was a very God man in the flesh. You think he needed his prayer time to get up a storm going? I believe he was praying for how weak his believers were. I believe he was praying for Peter. Because remember, he's an all-knowing God, and he knew Peter was coming down out of the ship. And he knew Peter was going to walk toward him. And you know what? He knew Peter was going to sink too. He was praying for them. He was praying for their rope. He was praying for them. And see, that's why when he came down walking on the sea, he says, it is I. Be not afraid, it is I. He was able to do that. Because he prayed. See, remember what they said about him? It's a spirit. But you know what? Our Lord Jesus had prayed. Our Lord Jesus was ready. When you go on a missionary trip, be ready. Listen, you're not there to be seen. And you're not there to get goo-goo gaga. You're there on the merit of Almighty God. You're an ambassador of Christ. We need to take it seriously. We need to be real about it. And so we find that they come, that he prays, he's prepared, he gets out, and he does the work, and he encouraged them a great deal at that time. Go with me to Acts chapter 16. Now, if you know the ministry of Paul, you know that he had a split with Barnabas. I think mostly over the young man, John Mark. There was problems there. John Mark was inconsistent. He was acting like a child. And you know what? If you study that out even and look at some historical commentary on that, John Mark was a child. He was about 16. And you know what? Paul did not let that be an excuse. He said he was a minister, and he said he was a believer, and he expected him to act like it. You know what? If you say you're a believer, I expect you to act like it. I don't want to hear, well, that's just the way it is today. I don't want to hear it. I expect you to act like it. You know what? The Bible says that they were called Christians first at Antioch. And you know why they were called that way? Because they acted like Christ. And you know what I believe believers do? They act like Christ. And if you don't act like Christ, if you don't have an interest in the things of Christ, I am very unconvinced And you ought to be too. Listen, this is not a day of foolishness. It's not. Listen, we're talking about carrying the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ unto all the world. That's a serious thing. That's incredible. You know why there's so many false doctrines today? Tell us, because the devil's done it. No, it's because somebody's picked up the Word of God and didn't take it seriously. That's what happened. We're ambassadors of Christ. We're to take that very seriously. And we know that Paul did. So Paul gave Barnabas the old heave-ho because he was defending John Mark. And they had this split of company. Now notice what happens. Acts chapter 16 and verse 7. Acts 16 and verse 7. And after they were come to Mysia, they essayed to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. Now, this is doing it the right way. If you want to spread the gospel, you know what? They had plans. We'll go down to Bithynia, and we'll start a little preaching point at Bithynia. That ain't no bad idea. But the Bible says the Spirit, Holy Ghost, large capital S Spirit, the Holy Spirit, said, don't you do it. Don't go. You know what? When the Spirit forbids something, you better leave it alone. He's a third of the Godhead, right? Do we not owe him the respect to say, you know what? He said not to go, so I don't think I'm going to do anything. I'm going to stay put. That's a good idea. Nothing wrong with having a mission down at Bithynia if God's in it. And if God's not in it, you don't need a mission at Bithynia. You need to wait until the Lord says you go this way or you go that way. And that was Paul's nature. He was led constantly of the Lord. So just the fact that he was going out, you know what he was getting down to? He was getting down to the point to be able to go off very precious seed with weeping. You know what? If he was a mind to go to Bithynia, there was people down at Bithynia that needed to be saved. But the will of God was more important than that, than him. So he's obedient. Missionaries that are who they ought to be are always obedient. Now notice in verse 8, and they passing by Mysia came unto Troas, and a vision appeared unto Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia praying and saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. And after he had seen the vision, immediately he endeavored to go into Macedonia. Now, you know what? That's another thing about once you get the burden, go. Once you hear clearly from Christ, just go do it and get the job done. You don't sit around on your laurels trying to get support for 15 years. If he tells you to go, go. You know what? I have the full belief that if he wants you there, he's going to provide exactly what you need.
Yeah.
Well, you might not be no three-bedroom brick. You see, that ain't even good enough anymore. Three-bedroom brick was 70s, 80s thing. Now it's a six-bedroom brick, right? With four bathrooms. It may not be that. But I'll tell you what. It'll be what you need. It'll be enough. It'll be exactly... keep the water off your head. And so we see then that we as the Lord's people, we ought to desire to be just like He was. When we get the call, just get up and go. The second part of verse 10, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us to go and preach the gospel unto them. Therefore, losing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, then the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of the Macedonians and colony, and we were come to the city, and we were in that city abiding certain days. Now, let me interject this. It didn't happen overnight. What was at Philippi? We know that Philippi. church of God at Philippi. But you know what? It didn't happen overnight. In fact, they got there and preached, and the Bible says here they're there 7 days. And then they went down to the water on the afternoon of the Sabbath. Found some women down there washing their clothes. Found a woman named Lydia, seller of purple. And other women was down there. But see, Lydia was one of God's people. They spoke, and Christ spoke life. And then the whole city began to be turned upside down for one woman's belief. In fact, she says, if you found me faithful, come over to my house. City got some mad at him, threw him in the clink. Down at the jail about midnight, they've been, and listen, we don't even know what a beating is. You think about the worst whooping you ever had as a child. Worst whooping I ever had. Think about part of all you have to be careful about every 40 years it gets washed away. And I was a kid, and I was playing in the backwater, and Mom never beat me so much in all my life. When I came out of the water, and she got me every step of the way up the creek bank, and I was bleeding from here down. You know what? I deserved it. When mine was in the backwater, I'd do the same thing. We need to be obedient, don't we? If he's saying go, go. So he said go, but it didn't happen overnight. That made him time to give up. So he said, we find Lydia saved. We find the city gets mad because, and you know what? Follow this out. It doesn't say anybody else ever got saved until that night down into jail. But it made the city mad that they were preaching, didn't it? It made them mad that they were sharing the gospel. One woman saved, and they was upset. You know what? This world is not going to be happy when people are truly saved. Now, they might be okay with you giving them some kind of little group hug or something, but sharing just the unadulterated gospel, they're not going to like it. And when people get saved, they're not going to be pleased with it. So they get thrown in the clink. They get a whipping like they've never been whipped. And at midnight, they began to sing and praise God. And it said the old jailer heard them. And the Lord saved him. In fact, I think the whole pile was saved. And the reason I come to that is this. It says their chains fell off. And what did Paul say to the Philippian jailer? Do thyself no harm, we're all here. And listen, if those other folks had not been saved, they'd been down there like the building was on fire. But you know, I believe they were saved, and they thought, you know what, I deserve to be here. I broke the law, and I'm going to pay my penance, and I'm going to be done. See, saved people began to think like saved people. Then the old jailer himself was saved, and the very stripes he had licked on them, he began to wash and to pat dry. See, that's what missionary work is. Finding the mind of God and going in prayer. And when it gets tough, keep going. When it gets difficult, stay with it. And bathe it every day in prayer. That's what we need to do is, Lord, you're interested in New Testament Baptist Church? Bathe it from floor to ceiling every day in prayer. That's what will make the difference.